this time for me was day. The sun rose as we were laying on our backs, and the calm seas looking off to the east from the pilot's seat were no foretelling of what's going to happen in a few hours. Next slide, please. The liftoff in the space shuttle is very violent. You know, each of the solids put out 3 million pounds of thrust. Together with the main engines, you've got 7 million pounds total in the first 2 minutes. You can hardly see the instruments were vibrating so violently. Next slide, please. We did have a pretty low deck this time, so all of our, I guess there were 500,000 people there. I got about 20 seconds of a show before we disappeared into the clouds. Next slide. But you know, an F-15 pilot who was patrolling the skies above us got this great shot as we shot out of the clouds. Next. On the second day, we started working robotics. Go ahead. Next slide. And you can see the shuttle's robotic arm with the boom, the OBSS, the orbiter boom sensor system we use to inspect our heat shields like we've been doing on the last couple dozen missions. Next slide. We did find a little bit of damage during that period of time, and I think we might show that to you later. And then we continued on for rendezvous on flight day 3. Next. You know, joining up on the space station when it's complete, it's huge. It's the size of a football field. And you get a sense of you're flying into something. It's kind of like Star Wars when Luke goes down into those little trenches. You can't see the entire space station in your peripheral vision once you get within about 400 or 600 feet. Next slide. And there's a beautiful view of the space station, just about complete, minus the OBSS that we left there, as well as the AMS and ELC. Next slide. Well, we joined in. You can see Mark being greeted by Paolo. And we had six Expedition crew members up there, Expeditions 27 and 28. The six of us made a total of 12. Next. And you can see us as we're getting our welcome ceremony for about 30 minutes. But it's interesting. It's like driving up to somebody's house, parking your Winnebago in their driveway, and then pulling their lawnmower out and getting to work. Because next slide, we started working on the ELC that very same day on flight day 3. ELC, the Express Logistics Carrier, had a bunch of stuff we were taking up at the space station. That and the AMS were the two big payloads that we installed on the top of the truss. Next slide. We did a dramatic handoff with each of those two payloads, and here you see. I think it was Mike. You were on the shuttle robotic arm with Drew.
Ricky Bobby were
Bobby. Yeah, and then the two Gregs. We were working the station arm, the space station arm, and did the handoff and then slapped it on top of the truss. Next. And now I'd like to introduce Ricky Bobby to continue the show.
It has been a great honor and privilege and thankful to NASA for this opportunity for me. Next slide. AMS is for sure the biggest experiment ever installed on the International Space Station. About $2 billion, 16 nations, about 16 years time to prepare this experiment. Out of curiosity, I have a master's degree in physics, and I was trained to search antimatter even before becoming an astronaut and even before becoming a pilot. So the coincidence for me to be the one to take AMS out of the bay was extremely unique for me. And I did have a little bit of anxiety, because not so much for the technique of extracting AMS, because flying space is very different from being on Earth. So that was, for me, one of the very first tasks. I didn't know what would have been my reaction once in space I was going to operate the robotic arm. Next slide, please. With my surprise, I found the robotic arm extremely smooth and pleasant, and I also got quickly adapted to microgravity. So the moment I took AMS out of the bay together with Drew was really emotional. Next slide, please. And then there was this also unique handshake between the shuttle robotic arm and the station robotic arm with box. on the other side. And that's for sure something that I want to underline as a unique moment. Flying space 400 kilometers above the Earth's surface, giving with this extremely peculiar and unique shake hand between the shuttle arm and robotic arm. Next slide, please. And this is one of the best features that we have with IMS already installed on the truss. Next slide, please. And you can see from here the logo, and Professor Ting Nobel Prize at this very moment was extremely happy. He's the principal investigator and is the father of IMS. Next slide, please. In addition to robotic operations, I also brought with me some experiments from Italy, from the Italian Space Agency. And just to underline that the International Space Station is a unique opportunity for research and for science. Next slide, please. And then I had the pleasure and the privilege to work a little bit with the ISS crew with stowage. Stowage is a word that I did not understand fully until I spent that week with Paolo Chedi, and I did my best to confuse their ideas and to confuse mine. In fact, I discovered that working microgravity as a crew member of the ISS is extremely challenging. You can close your eyes and put yourself in a place where everything is floating and start then to manage experiments and so many things at the same time that you can only imagine those. Next slide, please. And I also had an opportunity to work inside the European ATV. He was a doctor at that time. And I work with the ISS crew to unload and upload with trash. It might sound like something irrelevant, but it's extremely important to properly manage trash on board of the International Space Station. Next slide, please. Another unique moment for this space flight was the possibility to have a contact with the Pope, Benedict XVI, to look down to Earth from the International Space Station is really unique. And this in-flight call with the Pope fully underlined the peculiarity and underlined the space flight as a very special moment. Next slide. And I leave this now to Spanky.
And next slide, please. We talked about several of our big mission goals. That was to install the ELC-3 as well as to install the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer. We also were up there as one of the last shuttle flights to extend the life of the International Space Station. And like Katie and Paolo, I had the chance to live up there, and I'm very very much, I don't say in love, but I really like the space station a lot. Maybe it's called my BFF or something. I don't know. So it was a real privilege to get a chance to put on an American suit. I had previously spacewalked in Russian suits, so this was my first chance to go on an American suit and help extend the life of the space station. Here we have Greg Shamatov. This was his very first spacewalk. He had waited a long time for it, so we were happy to welcome him to be the 201st human being to go outside for a spacewalk. Next slide, please. And this is kind of, you can see there's in the middle of the screen, you can see that's Greg Shamatov. And on the right-hand side of the screen, you can see Drew Feustel hanging out there. In this case, they were working with the materials on the ISS experiment. We call it MISSI. And it exposes materials to the outside. And it's already, MISSI's one of the true success stories of the International Space Station. We were working with MISSI 8, but through the previous MISSIs, they've been able to come up with new materials for space that actually can save the extend the lives of satellites, and it's made over a $500 million improvement to our industry of building satellites. So just, I mean, it's just even sticking things outside the space station and seeing what exposure does to them really makes a difference. Next, please. And there's Drew taking a picture of the MISSI experiment, and you can see how huge the space station is compared to a human being. Next, please. And there's me. I don't know if you can see me smiling, but pretty much they didn't have to tell me to smile for the cameras because I was always smiling inside a spacesuit. Spacewalks are really difficult. We set a few milestones with the International Space Station. We were worried at the beginning of the space station that the spacewalks would be too much for us. We have over 1,000 hours as NASA, 1,000 hours of spacewalks to build the International Space Station. And we've done it always safely. And it's a big compliment to our NASA teams to be able to, first build and operate a spacesuit, but to do it safely with some very complex tasks. Next, please. And this is one of my favorite slides. There's me and my friend Drew Feustel, I think Mark took this picture from the cupola. And from the cupola, you can see so many things. Cupola is our window out to space. Katie and Paolo know about it more because they've got a chance to spend a long time looking at our beautiful planet from the cupola. But in this case, Mark was looking at us and took a nice picture. Next, please. And this is one of my other favorite pictures. You can see the Earth in the background, and my friend Drew just hanging by one hand to the outside of on the outside of space. Next, please. And this is, I think, our final spacewalking picture here. But you can see my friend Taz, and if you look carefully in his visor, you can see my reflection. And I'm sure behind the visor, Taz was smiling. But in this case, this is a really shot. This is kind of what I was seeing out there. Next. And this is the International Space Station. This is my favorite shot. And Taz took this. And at one end, on the left-hand side, you can see beautiful Shuttle Endeavour. And on the right-hand side, you can see the automated transfer vehicle, the ATV that Ricky Bobby was talking about. And you can see the whole stack, all of our pressurized modules in between. And then from the top of the slide to the bottom, you can see the truss. And this is what we've built together. And the International Space Station is a true symbol of what human beings, when we put our minds to it, what we can accomplish and what we can do when we work together constructively and not destructively. Next, please. We also, being a former station guy and with Katie and Paolo gone by now, they were there at the beginning of our mission. They left, took some great pictures on their way out. We missed them. So they put me and Taz to work along with the other station guys, and we took out the carbon dioxide removal assembly, the CEDRA. And next, please. Totally took it apart. Put it back together. Those things weigh about 350 pounds. Me and Taz can easily pick those up on Earth, but I'll tell you what, it's easier to pick them up in space. Next, please. We're strong. Yeah. And back to you, Mark.
Next slide. So we got some incredible photos during this mission. I don't think I took any of them. This is one where you can see the star field in the background with some of the new cameras and the limb of the Earth. And the station, I think that's a station end effector from the robotic arm. Next slide. And here's the space station, an incredible picture that Paolo took. This is when Katie and Paolo left us in the middle of the night. It was about 2 in our morning, so we were all asleep. And they undocked along with Dima and went home. But you can see Space Shuttle Endeavour sitting there right at the top of this image. It's the first time we've gotten a picture of the space shuttle attached to the space station, and it's certainly the last. Next slide. This is when Box did our fly around. It's a computer screen, but it shows the lap we do around the space station to take a bunch of pictures. The idea is to get really good images, detailed images of the station to see if there's any holes in anything broken, stuff we can't tell from the inside. We do a little survey by flying all the way around. Now, in our case, we did a first time what was called a re-rendezvous, where we came back to test a new sensor that we'll use on future spacecraft. Next slide. And this is the display of this new sensor that uses something equivalent. Well, it's a laser system, but it can give you what looks like an actual picture. If you see on the bottom, that blue shot almost looks in some ways like a photograph. But it'll give you range and closure rate, and the hope is that it'll do a better job of the sensors we have today, and we'll use this on the multi-purpose crewed vehicle or some of the commercial crew vehicles that'll visit space station in the future. And it worked really, really well. Next slide. And after 16 days, I don't know, 200 and something orbits, 6 million miles. It was time to come home. It's always sad to leave the space station the last time and to come home in the space shuttle. But fortunately, we have an incredible vehicle that can do something that no other spacecraft has been ever able to do with people on it, and that's to land on a runway. And Endeavour came back for its last time in the middle of the night, about 2 a.m. You know, I always find the space shuttle to be really amazing. Not so much, I mean, you know, it can carry a huge amount into space, a large payload into orbit. But it's what really amazes me is that when it comes home, it just slows down a little bit, and it basically you're in an airplane, and it crashes into the atmosphere at Mach 25. And all that energy you put in on the way up, you see all the flames coming out the back. Now you have to take all that energy back out, and the way you do that is by hitting the atmosphere. And that drag heats up the space shuttle, slows you down. Then you descend some more, you heat up more, slows you down further. And you go from 17,500 miles an hour to zero on the runway in a half lap around the planet. And, you know, we do it successfully most times, with one exception. And this was a great honor for me to be the commander of the Shuttle Endeavour for the last time it came back to Earth. So that's us touching down. Next slide. Okay, we didn't touch down yet. And we're a little bit left of center line. I think it was 9 feet left. But next slide. And that's the crew. We're missing two folks today. On either end, Drew Feustel is in the Czech Republic. And I think Taz is still in Australia. This week. So now we're going to show about a 15-minute video. We're not going to talk during the video. It's got a little music. It's got a little talking in it, but why don't we roll that? And then we'll do questions at the end.